Praise the Lord. I welcome you to our leaders development session tonight. And I pray that the Lord will make the best you can be as a leader in the church, in your various sections, in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this hour. Thank you for this moment of coming to look at your word again. And we're asking tonight that you send your word forth to every heart in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, you strengthen everyone in the inner man and build up your people as New Testament ministers, servants of God, and leaders in Jesus' name. Be glorified in our lives, glorified in our families, glorified in our ministries. And Lord, we pray a purposeful, fruitful ministry will follow after the path you are laying before us in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight we come together once again in our leaders' development session. And as you know, we'll be going through the epistles, the letters, the messages of the Lord Jesus Christ, the head of the church, unto each of the angels of the church, each of the leaders in the church, each of the ministers in the church. And today we're coming to number four. We've already treated the messages concerning the church in Ephesus, the church in Smyrna, and the church in Pergamos. Now we come to the church in Thyatira, and it's in Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 18. It's actually from verse 18 to verse 29, that is from verse 18 to the end of the chapter. I'll start by reading just verse 18. And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, this sixth says the Son of God, who has his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. As the Lord wrote to this church, he commended the church after introducing himself about their work, about their service, and about what we're doing. And they appear to be making progress and doing more than they ever did. Because your last works, he said, are more than your first works. But then he said, notwithstanding, nevertheless, but I have somewhat against you. And then he told them, he told that minister, he told the angel of the church what he had against him and against the church. And after that, he gave a word of counsel, a word of command. And he told him what to do with the people who are standing, and what to do with the people who are compromising. And that is the same message the Lord is sending to us today. The message today is titled, Cleansing the Church of Contagious Corruption. Cleansing the church of contagious corruption. And there are three things we're looking at as we look at the message. Number one, the declaration of the perfection of conquering Christ. Christ, you know, he conquered on the cross of Calvary. He conquered the grave. He conquered death. And he rose again triumphantly. He appeared to his own disciples with many infallible proofs that it is me, it is the Christ, the same Christ who died, who was buried, who rose again. And then after 40 days of that infallible revelation to his own disciples, he was taken to heaven. And he was taken to heaven without any help of any aeroplane or anything. He ascended into heaven. He conquered. And now he's seated on the right hand of majesty on high. The declaration he made and the perfection of that conquering Christ. Number two, the defilement and pollution of contagious corruptors. The defilement and pollution of contagious corruptors. There's a corruptor in that church, the church in Thyatira. And that corruptor did not just stand alone. After being corrupted by the devil, she now went on to defile other people and then to pass on that pollution. Anywhere there is corruption, you'll discover that the one that has been corrupted will become a corrupter. And not only that, the corruption becomes contagious. That is, it contaminates other people going from one to the other. And that's why it's not good to leave a corrupter, a backslider, a compromiser in a church. Just like that, uncorrected, untouched, and then just left like that, because their corruption will spread to other parts of the church. But now, point number three is the diligence and purity of courageous conquerors. You understand? If we're going to conquer, it takes courage, courage of heart, courage of mind, courage of spirit, courage of action, courage of disposition, courage at every corner of the road, and courage every time, everywhere, in everything, and with anyone. If we're going to conquer, that's what the Lord is calling every church to. And at the end of the message, at the end of the epistle, at the end of the letter that he wrote to any of the churches, will say, he that overcometh. In other words, he that conquers, and that takes courage. And it's going to take diligence, it's going to take purity and perseverance if we're going to conquer. I pray you'll be a conqueror in Jesus' name. The diligence and the purity of courageous conquerors. Point number one, in point number one, we're looking at the declaration and perfection of conquering Christ. We're coming back to Revelation chapter 2 verse 18. And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things says the Son of God, who has his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. We come to verse 19 now. In verse 19 it says, I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and thy patience. That actually means your patient perseverance. And then thy works, and the last will be more than the first. Here is what we know about Christ. Number one is the divinity of Christ as the Son of God. The divinity of Christ as the Son of God. Number two is the dominion of Christ as the sword of God. The dominion of Christ as the sword of God. And in that verse 19 we have read, number three now, is the discernment of Christ, the searchlight of God. Let's go to number one in Revelation chapter 2 verse 18. The divinity of Christ, the Son of God. It's going to be interesting to you, instructive to us, to know that this is the only place where this title, the Son of God, appears in the book of Revelation. In other parts, like chapter 1, the Son of Man. But here, the Son of God. What does that mean? And why is he introducing himself as the Son of God? It's because of his divinity. Look at this. And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things says the Son of God. Look at John chapter 5, reading from verse 25. John chapter 5, verse 25, it says, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. The dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. Moses couldn't talk like that. He was just a human being. And Joshua or David or any of the other prophets of the Old Testament couldn't talk like that. Neither any of the apostles in the New Testament to call to say that they will hear their voice. Paul could not have said, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the apostle Paul. He couldn't say that, but the Son of God, because of his divinity, is greater than any man, greater than every man in any generation. He is the Son of God, and he says, the time is coming, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. That's peculiar to the Lord Jesus Christ because of his divinity. Look at verse 26. In verse 26 it says, for as the Father has life in himself, so as he given unto the Son to have life in himself. You know, the life of every other person depends on Christ, depends on God, depends on the Creator. But he, the one that was not created, the eternal one, the divine one, it says that the Father has life in himself. So as he giving to the Son to have life in himself. In verse 27, it says in verse 27, and has given him authority. Has given him authority, total authority, complete authority, eternal authority, universal authority. God has given him, the Son of God, authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man, Son of God, Son of Man. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14, Hebrews chapter 4, we're looking at verse 14, and it says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our profession. He's passed into the heavens, and he didn't go there to mix with the angels, to be the same as the angels. He's sitting at the right hand of power, at the right hand of glory, at the right hand of majesty on high, because he's Jesus, the Son of God. It tells us in chapter 7, verse 3, about the Son of God, without beginning, without end, it says, without father and without mother and without descent, having neither the beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ, his divinity. Let's look at 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. 1 John chapter 3 verse 8, it tells us, he that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. Look at this now. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested. The Son of God, that's our Lord. The Son of God, that's the captain of our salvation. The Son of God, that's the divine one, the eternal one, eternal Emmanuel, God with us. It says, for this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That he might destroy the works of the devil. Because he's divine, that's why he has dominion. Unchallengeable dominion, final dominion, total dominion, universal dominion, eternal dominion. That takes us to the second section, the dominion of Christ, the Son of God. The dominion of Christ, the Son of God. It tells us in Revelation chapter 2, we're reading from verse 18. Revelation chapter 2 verse 18, and unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things says the Son of God, who has his eyes like unto a flame of fire, like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. Look at chapter 1, Revelation chapter 1, reading from verse 14, still describing Christ in his glory, in his majesty, in his unchallengeable power and authority, in his universal dominion. His head and his ears were like white wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. In verse 15 it says, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burnt in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. For you to understand the implication of that, that this is Christ, this is the Son of God, and he describes the fiery sight coming out of his mouth and out of his face, and then he talks about his feet as if they were burnt in the furnace. And let's go to Daniel chapter 7, and we're reading from verse 9. Daniel chapter 7, reading from verse 9, it says, and I beheld the thrones were cast down, and the ancient of this, that's God the Father, and the ancient of this, that's God Almighty, and the ancient of this did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was like fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. Then in verse 10, it says in verse 10, a fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 stood before him, and the judgment was set, and the books were opened. And it tells us in verse 13, it says, and I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of God. That's the Lord, that Jesus Christ, capital S there. One like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. And came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him, Christ, near before him, the Father. And in verse 14 it says, and there was given him dominion. There was given him, our Christ, our conqueror, our captain, the captain of our salvation, the Son of God, the Son of Man, the one that is the Father of eternity, the origin of eternity. Wonderful. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. It says, and there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Well, it's very clear to you, very clear to everyone, that this Jesus is going to be the final power, the final authority, and he has this universal, unchallengeable dominion because he is the final judge. Look at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 17, verse 31. Acts chapter 17, we're looking at verse 31. It says, because he has appointed a day, God has appointed a day, in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he has ordained, whom he has anointed, whom he has appointed, whereof he has given assurance unto all men that he has raised him from the dead. And he tells us in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, reading from verse 7, talking about this dominion that Christ is going to have, and the final power and authority Christ is going to have, in 2 Thessalonians 1, 7. And to you who are troubled, rest with us. Any challenge, rest with us. Any persecution, rest with us. Any suffering, physical suffering, emotional suffering, or whatever it is, rest with us. When the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. Look at what he's going to do in verse 8. It says in verse 8, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to find out, he's going to search out, he's going to reveal all those that are not obedient to the gospel. The gospel of grace, they are not obedient to the gospel. The gospel of peace, they are not obedient to the gospel. The gospel of God, they are not obedient to the gospel. And the gospel of righteousness, they are not obedient to the gospel. And it says the Lord, when he comes, he'll find out everyone. He'll search out everyone, and he will have vengeance, he will have retribution, he'll have punishment for them that know not God, that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. How would he know? He knows all things. That brings us to a third section now, the discernment of Christ, the searchlight of God. He's the Son of God, is the sword of God, and is the searchlight of God. Look at Revelation chapter 2, verse 19. Revelation chapter 2, verse 19. I know thy works. I know thy works. And you understand that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And like he said at that time, he's still saying today, I know thy works. Like God the Father knows, he knows. True. He knows our activities. He knows our works. He knows everything at the background of our works. He knows all the activities, and he knows the motive, and he knows the direction. He knows the reason for the works. And Jesus Christ, the searchlight of God, the one that looks at our heart, and there is nothing hidden before him. It says, I know thy works, and I know thy charity. I know thy service. I know thy faith. I know thy patience. I know thy works. He mentions the works again. Why did he mention that again? Because he's going to comment on that. And the last to be more than the first. And the last to be more than the first. Think about this now. He knows you through and through. He knows your down sitting. He knows your uprising. He knows your activities. He knows your disposition. He knows your thoughts. He knows everything about you, about me, about everyone. And he's talking to you directly. Well, you understand, the angel of the church in Thyatira is come and gone. We are the people there today. You are the person there today. And the Lord is speaking to you saying, I know thy works. You have some charity. I know thy charity. You have some service. Are you active? Are you occupied? Are you winning souls? Are you evangelizing? Are you witnessing? Are you interceding? Are you counseling? Are you teaching the word of God? I know thy service. Are you serving the church? Are you serving humanity? Are you serving everyone without any discrimination? I know thy service. Are you serving from the heart? Or are you serving with eye service? I know thy service, and I know thy faith. Your faith in Christ, the faith that brings us into salvation, and the faith that brings us into relationship with the Lord. I know thy faith, and the faith that keeps on standing, and the faith that will not bend, even though things may be happening, and the wind is blowing there, and the storm is coming there, and you have your faith in Christ, and you will not move, and you will not be displaced, and you will not be distracted by whatever is happening. Because I know your faith, the faith of the Son of God that we ought to walk by, that we ought to live by. I know thy faith. And he says, I know thy patience. Isn't that what the Lord expects of us today, every minister? Thy patience, you're patient with problems, you're patient with people, you're patient with circumstances, you're patient with situations. I know thy patience. Can we say that about you? Well, we say charity begins at home. We say service should begin at home. And faith should begin at home. And patience should begin at home. Are we patient at home? With our wives? With our husbands? With our children? With the workers all around us? With neighbors in our community? Or do we just want it now and now? If it doesn't happen now, somebody there is going to get angry. And somebody there is going to flare up. And somebody there is going to have fury and anger. But when we are patient, it wants us to be patient in whatever problem we're going through. Patient in problems, patient with people, and patient even in persecution. And then he says, I know thy works, in the plural. I know thy works. Do you know your own works? Are you doing something for the Lord? And then he says, and the last will be more than the first. I love that. I think you ought to appreciate that too, that this angel, that this minister, that this leader in the church of Thyatira, that the last was more than the first. Have you noticed people, generally people, they slow down as they get older. They slow down after they've worked for 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 30 years. They slow down, and their last works will be less than the first. God expects you, God expects me, that as we grow, we have more knowledge. As we grow, we have more grace. As we grow, we have more perseverance. As we grow, we have more patience. As we grow, we have more power, more strength, and more focus, and more purpose. And the Lord should be able to say concerning you, concerning me, concerning us, and your last works to be more than the first. What a commendation the Lord had for him. But the point is, he knows everyone. Look at Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9. Jeremiah chapter 17, we're looking at verse 9. The Lord is saying, the heart is deceitful above all things. That sin, you know, sometimes your heart can congratulate you that you're doing well when you are not doing so well, because the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? He tells us in verse 10, who knows the heart? He says, the Lord searches the heart. I try the reins even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings. He knows us through and through, and we cannot hide from him. In fact, he tells us in Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 23. Jeremiah chapter 23, reading from verse 23, he says, am I a God at hand, says the Lord, and not a God afar off? Do I see only the things that are near, and I don't see the things that are far away? Look at the answer in verse 24. In verse 24, can any hide himself in secret places that I shall not see him, says the Lord? Do not I feel heaven and earth, says the Lord? It says, I know all things in heaven, all things on earth, all things everywhere, in any part of the world, all things in every generation, all things in your location there, all things in your family there, all things in your heart there, all things anywhere we are, he knows all things. The good things he knows, the bad things he knows, the commendable things he knows, the contemptible things he knows. He knows everything. He says, I feel the heavens and the earth, says the Lord. Look at John chapter 16, verse 30. In John chapter 16, looking at verse 30, here the disciples, now they were talking to the Lord Jesus Christ, and he said, now are we sure? Now are we sure that thou knowest all things? Underline that in your Bible, that thou knowest all things people do behind the curtain, thou knowest all things people do behind closed doors. You know all things people are thinking about and they are planning, all the projects, all the plan. I know all things, all the reasons for being here, all the reasons for not being there. It says, we're sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest forth from God. Look at chapter 21, and we're reading from verse 17. The relationship and what happened, interaction between Christ and Simon Peter. He says unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? Look at this, look at this. And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. You don't have to be there physically. Thou knowest all things. We don't even have to talk. We don't have to testify. We don't have to open our mouth. Thou knowest all things. We don't have to bring our thoughts out before you know. Thou knowest all things. You know the disposition of the heart. You know the intention of the heart. You know the plan of life. You know everything about everyone anywhere. And when the day of judgment will come, you will manifest that knowledge. Thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. On the basis of that, Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, reading from verse 12, is saying about the word of God, the word that comes out of the mouth of God. For the word of God is quick, is active, is alive, and is powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner. It's a discerner. He discerns everything of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Verse 13 makes it very clear. Neither is there any creature anywhere, neither is there any creature in any church or outside the church in any community, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight. but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. All things are open, all things are plain, all things are clear, all things are revealed and open unto the eyes of him we have to do. Who is that him with whom we have to do? Christ, the Son of God. Christ that has divinity. Christ that has dominion. And Christ that has discernment. We're coming back to Revelation chapter 2. And we're reading from verse 20 all through to verse 23. Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 20. And we're reading to verse 23. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself, understand, she calleth herself, Christ did not call her prophetess, she calleth herself, God did not appoint her prophetess, she calleth herself, the word of God does not affirm her prophetess, but she calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. In verse 21, it says, in verse 21, and I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. In verse 22, it says, behold, I will cast her into a bed, that's a bed of suffering, a bed of sickness, a bed of affliction, a bed of punishment, a bed of torment. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, into great suffering that had never been before nor ever shall be, except they repent of their deeds. And then in verse 23, and it says, and I will kill her children, I will kill her followers, I will kill the people, I will destroy the people, I will judge those converts, the people that are disciples, her children were dead. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and hearts, and I will give unto every one of you, every one of you without exception, every one of you according to your works. There are three things we're looking at here. Number one, the great transgression. The great transgression. Number two, the great tribulation. Number three, the great torments. Number one, the great transgression of an unrestraining compromiser. Who is that? The angel of that church. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, the angel of the church, the leader of the church, the minister of the church, the one standing at the forefront of that church, teaching others, ministering to others, doing the work of God, but doing the work of God deceitfully. Because he became a compromiser. He remained a compromiser. He was active. He was serviceable. He was devoted. He was much occupied. But, as we said the other week, he turned a blind eye to the things that were happening within the church, notwithstanding. I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest, thou permittest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce, to teach and to entice, to teach and to draw people into sin, to teach and to seduce my servants. Who are those workers? Who are those preachers in that church? Who are those? Those who are also leading along with the leader, along with the senior pastor of the church, to teach and seduce my servants to commit fornication, Can you imagine that? That this preacher kept on preaching, kept on serving, and kept on persevering, and kept on running up and down. And yet there was a woman who was having more influence, negative influence upon the church, upon even the workers, even the servants of God, and then the members of the church, convincing them against the message of the word of God that they could commit fornication. How? Because she did it by example. Because she did it by a pattern, what she was laying down, and then talking to other people, I'm doing it. If it were wrong, would I be doing it? After all, I'm a prophetess. And maybe a man could also say, after all, I'm a prophet, I'm a preacher. After all, I am a leader. And if it were wrong, would I be doing it? There are people that do wrong things like that, and then they try to convince others that if they could do it, that it was all right. My brother, my sister, nothing is all right except it agrees with the Bible, the word of God. And because of that, this compromiser that will not restrain that prophetess, that corrupter, Christ adds something against him. You remember in Exodus chapter 32, when Moses went to the top of the hill. Exodus chapter 32, and we're reading there from verse 7. Exodus chapter 32, verse 7, Moses had gone to the mountaintop, and he went to receive the law from the Lord. And Aaron, the compromiser, Aaron that had a straw for backbone, Aaron like a jellyfish, Aaron one leg in the sea, one leg on the land, Aaron that could not stand alone and firm. It says, and the Lord said unto Moses, go, get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. How? Look at the next verse 21. In verse 21, it says, and Moses said unto Aaron, what did these people unto thee, that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them, great sin, great transgression? In verse 22. In verse 22, it says, and Aaron said, let not the anger of my Lord wax hot. Thou knowest the people. Thou knowest the people, I couldn't stand them. Thou knowest the people, you know their pressure. Thou knowest the people, whenever they want something, they wanted it now. And whether it was right or wrong, they will put pressure on whoever is there. You are the only one, Moses, that could withstand them. You know me, and you know the people. Thou knowest the people, that they are set on mischief. They are set on mischief. They could even have stoned me if I didn't give in to their request. That's a compromiser who could not restrain other people. And look at 1 Samuel chapter 3. In 1 Samuel chapter 3, reading from verse 11, it tells us now this about Aaron. And it says, and the Lord said unto Samuel, behold, I will do a thing in Israel, at which both the ears of everyone that heareth it shall tingle. Why? Look at verse 12. It says in verse 12, in that day I will perform against Eli all things which I have spoken concerning his house. When I begin, I will also make an end. What's the problem? What did Eli do? And what was the action of Eli that made God so unhappy with him, that said, every promise I gave him, I'm going to take away. And every privilege I gave him, I'm going to take away. And I'm going to bring judgment upon him and upon his house, that every ear that hears shall tingle. Look at verse 13. In verse 13, it says, for I have told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knoweth, because his sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not. You know what the Lord is saying? He's saying, when we allow any of our children to pollute the ministry, to destroy the ministry, to defile the ministry, when we permit any of our sons, when we permit any of our daughters to turn the standard of the word of God upside down, and then we take it like a family issue, We see these children, we talk to them, they will not hear. These children, we counsel them, they will not hear. And they're laying bad example. Look at, you know, what they're doing. This one is getting pregnant before marriage, and this one is impregnating another one. This one is cohabiting with, you know, people in the church, and this one is doing this and that exam malpractice. And what can I do now? As, you know, I'm growing older. I want to be soft. I want to be gentle. I want to be peaceful. But these children, anyway, I leave you in the hands of God. God says, I'll judge such a leader. I'll judge such a pastor. Or maybe it is a wife that is influencing the husband, like Jezebel influenced Ahab negatively. The wife has now come in and, you know, never say anything negative about a woman. Never say anything negative about your wife. Whatever she's doing, she's turning the ministry upside down, and she's bringing everything down the drain, and every sound doctrine of the word of God, she's contradicting everything and teaching other people. And others are saying, well, if the pastor's wife can do that, they don't even call her Jezebel, they call her prophetess, they call her a mother in Israel, a mother in the church, and yet she's making the standard of the gospel, the word of sanctification, the word of holiness. Nobody wants to believe that anymore, because the wife of that pastor is bringing everything into the mud, to the ground, and the man is saying, well, it's my wife, it's my better half, it's my darling, it's my eye, it's everything to me. What can I do? She's the mother of my children, she's the one feeding me. That's what the Lord is saying, that you become a compromiser and you become like Ahab. Ahab that could not do anything because of the influence of Jezebel. And the Lord is saying, whether it's your child, a son, whether it's your child, a daughter, or whether it's your darling wife, or whether it is your junior brother that is in the ministry, or anyone in the ministry that will pollute the gospel, that will defile the gospel, that will defile the standard of the word of God, because you do not have the courage, the backbone, to talk to the people that want to destroy the work of the Lord. The Lord says, I will do something. I will judge. And every ear that hear shall tingle. And look at this Jezebel of the Old Testament in 1 Kings chapter 21. 1 Kings chapter 21. And we're reading from verse 20. 1 Kings chapter 21. We're looking at verse 20. And Ahab said to Elijah, "Hast thou found me, O mine enemy?" There you are. Now Ahab counted Elijah as an enemy. Why? Because the wife is always talking against Elijah at home. I don't like his forthrightness. I don't like his, you know, his being pointed every time. I don't like the way he talks. I don't like the way he carries himself. I don't like the way he dealt with those prophets of Baal. That's the one thing I want to be remembered for, that I brought into the land of Israel. And now that man wiped away all those things. I'm against him. And because of that, Ahab the husband has got that same hatred for Elijah. "Hast thou found me, O mine enemy?" And he answered, "I have found you, because thou hast sold thyself to work evil in the sight of the Lord." You have sold yourself, you have given yourself to work evil in the sight of the Lord. Look at verse 25. In verse 25, it says, "But there was none like unto Ahab, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel, his wife, stirred up." Whom Jezebel, his wife, stirred up. Well, the Lord is telling us that that same person, or the appearance of Jezebel, appeared in the church in Thyatira. And the pastor there, the leader of the church there, the angel of the church in Thyatira, was so weak, and his hands were down, and his backbone was weak, and his shoulders were down, and his heart will be palpitating. Every time he wants to correct something going wrong, he'll be afraid, he'll be panicking as if somebody is going to kill him. And the Lord said, I have something against you. You know the truth. You're preaching the truth. You're serving. You're evangelizing. You're occupied. But this weakness of the mind, I have that against you. The Lord wanted him to repent. If you are like that, my brother, if you are like that, my sister, that the word of God does not take root and effect in your life, and you are panicking and you are afraid, and anytime you see something wrong, instead of coming forth and correcting it, you're always thinking, what will they do? How will they accept? How will they respond? If I do it like this, what will happen? You're not thinking about the Lord. You are thinking about the people. God says, I have something against you. Because of that great transgression. Come to number two now. The great tribulation. In Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 20. Revelation chapter 2, we're looking at verse 20. It says, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, that calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication. Hold on. If you commit fornication, don't say so-and-so influenced me. You have your Bible and you can read Mark chapter 7 verse 21 to 27. You have your Bible, you can read Romans chapter 1 verse 28 to verse 32. You have your Bible, you can read 1 Corinthians chapter 6 verses 9 and 10. You have your Bible, you can read in Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 to 21. You have your Bible, you can read Revelation chapter 21 and in verse 8. And it says very clearly, you cannot give any excuse. It's so-and-so that influenced me. It's so-and-so that influenced me. If you yourself, if you go into sin, you know that whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. For his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin, he will not sin. Because the seed of God abides in him. But these people, they allowed somebody to teach them and to seduce them to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. In verse 21, it says, and I gave her space to repent of her fornication. I gave her space to repent, and she repented not. Maybe she heard, some of the weak messages that pastor would preach, and she repented not, and the Spirit of God spoke to her heart, and she repented not. You know, there are people like that. They hear it over and over, and they do not repent, and they are adamant in their fornication, and they are adamant in their adultery, and they are adamant in their idolatry, and they are adamant in their witchcraft, and they are adamant in their occultism. Don't let the stubbornness and the willfulness of a Jezebel, of a corrupter, to influence you and then to close your mouth. Keep on saying it. Jesus said, and I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. And then in verse 22, it says in verse 22, behold, I will cast her into a bed. I will. It's not that I may. You know, Jezebel could not stop the action of Christ because he is the judge, is the final judge, and he has final dominion, and he has universal dominion, and he has eternal dominion, and he has dominion over all flesh, over everyone. And so even though the angel of the church in Tatara might compromise, might chicken out, might be weak, might not have good a strong backbone, yet Jesus said, behold, I will cast her into a bed of affliction, of judgment, of punishment, and them that commit adultery with her. Think about that. Them that commit adultery with her. Them is like, you know, that Jezebel there will not even keep to her husband alone. But adultery here, adultery anywhere she went, anyone she contacted, she had a way of sucking them into evil. And all those people, the Lord said, there's going to be eternal judgment upon them and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation. Those are the words of Jesus, except they repent of their deeds. It tells us in the word of God, it tells us in Luke chapter 13, reading from verse 3. Luke chapter 13, reading from verse 3, I tell you, nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Except you repent, you will perish. Look at verse 5. In verse 5, it says again, in verse 5 of that Luke chapter 13, I tell you, nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. It tells us that there's going to be indignation and there's going to be wrath on the people that do not repent of their sins. It tells us in Romans chapter 2, reading from verse 4. Romans chapter 2, reading from verse 4, it says, oh, despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? You know, the grace of God still available, leading to repentance, and the healing of God and the forgiveness of God and the promise of God and the love of God, that is not to be taken for granted. The love of God is not to be taken for granted, like, well, God is love, whatever happens, I'll come out of this. No. It says that love, that goodness, that grace, that manifestation of his kindness is leading you to repentance. Look at verse 5. It says in verse 5, but after thy hardness and impenitent heart, after thy hardness and unrepentant heart, after thy stubbornness and unrepentant heart, after thy disobedience and thy impenitent heart, after thy willfulness and thine impenitent heart, thou treacherest up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. It says in verse 8, it says, but unto them that are contentious, instead of being humble, instead of being contrite, instead of repenting, instead of bending low, instead of giving themselves to the Lord, unto them that are contentious, they argue against the truth, they contend against the truth, they contradict the truth, they oppose the truth, unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath. And then in verse 9, it says in verse 9, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man. Tribulation and anguish, pain, torment, judgment, anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first and also of the Gentile. And when that happens, what's going to happen? Look at this third part now, is the great torments, the great torments appointed for unclean companions. It tells us in Revelation chapter 2, verse 23, it says, and I will kill her children, her cohorts, her company, her companions, the people that compromise with her, the people who are corrupted because of her example, because of her action, and because of her ungodly counsel. And I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he that searches the reins and hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. Is telling us that there's judgment at the end of life. Even in this life, there is judgment, because God is looking at everything and Christ is searching everything out, and he wants us to be righteous. That's why we're saved. That's why Jesus gave himself on the cross of Calvary. And you don't want anything or anyone, you don't want any influence or anybody's teaching, anybody false doctrine to cancel the power of the cross in your life and then lead you down into degradation, into defilement, and into evil. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 2 verse 1, Hebrews chapter 2 verse 1, it says, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them sleep. In verse 2, it says, in verse 2, for if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, And every transgression and disobedience receive a just recompense of reward. Verse 3, then how shall we escape? How shall we escape? All those followers of Jezebel, how will they escape? And Jezebel herself, how will she escape? And Judas Iscariot and the people that want to corrupt other people, how will he escape? And Samson and Delilah, how will they escape? And those who bring corruption into the house of God, and those who bring defilement, and those who mutilate and destroy and defile the body of Christ and the people of Christ and the doctrines of the Bible, how will they escape? And those who bring the Baal worship and the idolatrous worship and the eating of things sacrificed to idols, and they bring fornication from the world, and they bring adultery from the world, and they bring pornography from the world, how will they escape if they do not repent? That's what the Lord is saying. There's going to be great torment appointed for those unclean companions. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? Look at Hebrews chapter 10, we're reading from verse 29. Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 29. It says of how much sorrow punishment. How much sorrow punishment, you understand that? Those who lived in the time of Sodom and Gomorrah, there was punishment. But those who are doing this now, sorrow punishment, greater punishment, and fiercer punishment, and it's a more painful punishment. Of how much sorrow punishment Dathan, Korah, and Abiram, it was a great punishment because they contradicted the truth. It says of how much sorrow punishment now all those in the old covenant, in the old testament, that saw the word of God, but they went into idolatry, and they went into occultism, and they went into idol worship, and they went into Baal worship. There was judgment upon them. It's saying now that we come to the new covenant, and Christ has died for us, and anybody that still goes into defilement, anybody that still spread the corruption from him, from her, to other people, of how much sorrow punishment, suppose he, shall he be thought worthy who have trodden underfoot the Son of God, and has counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified. He was sanctified. He was sanctified. He counts that blood now that sanctified him an unholy thing, and has done despite unto the Spirit of grace. In verse 30, it says, in verse 30, for we know him that has said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, says the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. In verse 31, it says, in verse 31, it is a fearful sin to fall into the hands of the living God. It is a fearful sin to keep on rebelling and keep on sinning and keep on compromising and keep on rejecting the word of God and keep on sacrificing to idols. It is a fearful sin to keep on in that evil way until the point of death, until the point of no return. It is a fearful sin to fall into the hands of the living God. In Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 25. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25. It says in verse 25, see that ye refuse not him that speaketh. Christ is speaking today. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh. Christ is counseling today, and Christ is enlightening us today, and Christ is saying this is what will happen eventually to the people that do not repent. So see that ye refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. You understand? When Christ spoke to the church in Ephesus, the church in Smyrna, and the church in Pergamos, the church in Thyatira, he was speaking from heaven. And he says, if those people did not escape, who disobeyed, who refused, who disregarded the word spoken on earth, much more we shall not escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. Revelation chapter 21, verse 8. In Revelation chapter 21, reading from verse 8, it says, for the fearful, maybe that was a problem of the pastor in the church in Thyatira, fearful, timid, trembling, not having the strength to stand and to declare the word of God, and the unbelieving, this is what Christ said, and some people say, it will not happen to me, even whatever I do, I know it will not happen. The unbelieving, they don't believe the word of God, and they're abominable. Those who eat things sacrificed to idols, and those who commit fornication, adultery, whether they do it with bold, brazen face, or they do it, you know, privately, anyone, it says, and the murderers, and the whoremongers, and the sorcerers, and the idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. What's the counsel that the Lord is giving us now that brings us to point number three? Point number three is the diligence and the purity of courageous conquerors. The diligence and the purity of courageous conquerors. My brother, if we're going to be ministers and pastors that God will reward on the final day, this is one thing we require. Being courageous. You know what God told Joshua? He said, have not I commanded you, be of good courage, be strong and of a good courage. You know, if we're going to keep to the watch of God in these last days, when the pressure is so much and when the persecution might be so intense, if we're going to keep to the watch of God, we need that courage. And that is the one thing Satan does not want a believer to have. That is the one thing Satan does not want a minister, a child of God, a minister of God to have. That is one thing the world does not want a minister of God to have. And that is one thing your persecutor or the people that may want to entice you into evil, that is one thing they don't want you to have. They don't want you to have the courage to say no. They don't want you to have the courage to challenge evil and to say that is not right, that must not be done, and Satan will do everything to erode your courage, but you will not allow it to happen. Give me a good amen. It will not happen to you. You will keep your courage because you cannot be a conqueror. You cannot be a victim. You cannot be an overcomer except you have the courage of the conqueror, the courage of the victor, the courage of the overcomer. And you need the diligence and the purity of courageous conquerors. There are three things we're looking at. Number one, spiritual distancing from contaminating deaths of Satan. Look at Revelation chapter 2 and in verse 24. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put none other sin, no other burden upon you. It says you must keep your distance. I'm sure you have heard about social distancing, that if you don't want to catch coronavirus, if you don't want to catch COVID-19, if you don't want to catch that disease that is spreading everywhere, apart from using face mask or, you know, any kind of mask, you must keep your distance. The same thing spiritually, there must be spiritual distancing from contaminating depths of Satan. You will keep yourself away, far away from evil and from any influence of Jezebel, any influence of Ahab, any influence of the Canaanites, any influence of the worldly people. It tells us in Leviticus chapter 18, and we're looking at verse 3. Leviticus chapter 18, we're reading from verse 3. After the doings of the land of Egypt, wherein ye dwelt, shall ye not do? And after the doings of the land of Canaan, whither I bring you, shall ye not do, neither shall ye walk in their ordinances. All those Egyptian practices, all those worldly practices, you keep your spiritual distance far away from them. You distinguish yourself, you mark yourself out, you stand out and you stand afar, that people will know you are totally different. In Deuteronomy chapter 12, verses 30 and 31, Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 30, take heed to thyself that thou be not snared by following them after that they be destroyed from before thee, and that thou inquire not after their gods, saying, how did these nations serve their gods? Even so will I do likewise. He said, keep your distance. In verse 31, in verse 31, thou shalt not do so unto the Lord thy God, for every abomination to the Lord which he hateth, which he hateth, have they done unto their gods, for even their sons and their daughters have they burnt in the fire unto their gods. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, Deuteronomy chapter 18, reading from verse 9, it tells us there very clearly as well to keep our distance. When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abominations of those nations. Don't read their books, and don't listen to their talk, and don't listen to all the glib and the gliding things they say. In verse 10, it tells us there shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch. And then in verse 11, it says, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer. And then in verse 12, for all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord. And because of these abominations, the Lord thy God does drive them out from before thee. Look at verse 13. It says, thou shalt be perfect with the Lord thy God. Thou shalt be perfect with the Lord thy God. How will that happen? Keep your spiritual distance from any sin and everything that will contaminate you. Look at the second part now. We're coming back to Revelation chapter 2. Verse 25, Revelation chapter 2, we're looking at verse 25. This is steadfast devotion to the complete doctrines of Scripture. Steadfast devotion to the complete doctrines of Scripture. It says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 25, for that which thou hast, which ye have already, hold fast till I come. They can call you names, you know, Jezebel will come. You know, it's in this same chapter, it's in this same church where Jezebel, calling herself a prophetess, influencing this, influencing that. They might come to you and say, you know, so-and-so had accepted the ideology, so-and-so has accepted the defilement, so-and-so, you know, has accepted the freedom, can easily eat and freely eat things sacrificed to idols now. In fact, so-and-so, he has a same partner, she has a same partner. How about you? They'll put the pressure on you. Number one, you keep your distance, spiritual distance, away from them. But should in case they still come, after you have kept your distance from them, they might send a text, they might use whatever technology, and they might want to get to you. Know what you have, keep what you have, hold what you have, hold fast what you have, whether they come in the day or they come in the night, whether they come through other people who have compromised or they come directly, but that which you have already, hold fast. till I come. You hold fast the word of God, the doctrines of the word of God, from the very beginning to the end, the commencement of the word, until the finality, the consummation of the word. I'm talking about repentance. I'm talking about restitution. I'm talking about righteousness. I'm talking about water baptism. I'm talking about everything that you've got, holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. I'm talking about one man, one wife, until death do you part. I'm talking about not going to court. I'm talking about settling all your problem in a biblical way. I'm talking about not carrying the weapons of the world to solve your problem. I'm talking about evangelism. I'm talking about every doctrine of the word of God, sanctification after salvation. It says that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. I'm talking about the power of the Holy Ghost. When the Holy Ghost comes upon you and within you and saturates you, I'm talking about keeping to every jot and every tittle of the word of God, all the doctrines of the Bible about the rapture, about the great tribulation, and about the second coming of the Lord, and about the millennial reign, about the white throne judgment. Everything you have learned, everything from cover to cover, you'll not add anything, you'll not take anything away, but that which ye have already. What do you have already? Since you have become a minister, you have become a leader, what do you have already? That which ye have already. Hold fast till I come. It means that before anyone, in the sight of anyone, in spite of anyone, despite the action of anyone, that which you have already, you hold fast until he comes. And if you're going to do that, you need to learn how to say no. No to your flesh, and no to your own pleasure, and no to ease in life, and no to every enemy, and no to every compromiser, and no to everyone that will try to put pressure on you to do evil. That which ye have already, hold fast until I come. It tells us in chapter 3, Revelation chapter 3, and I'm looking at verse 11. Revelation chapter 3, verse 11, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast. Hold it fast. Don't hold it with a loose hand. Don't let the devil knock it out of your hand, out of your heart, out of your mouth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Can you imagine all that God has helped you to do by grace? All that God has helped you to suffer, all that God has helped you to lay down, and you've laid it down with much sweat and much agony and much sweating and much persecution, and then to allow just one Jezebel somewhere floating in the air, neither here or there, to knock it out of your hand. God forbid, you will not allow that to happen. The wisdom we have as a child of God, the wisdom we have as a minister of the gospel, is to hold that fast which we have, that no man will take our crown. Look at the stately dominion for conquering disciples and saints. We're coming to Revelation chapter 2, verse 26. In Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 26, he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end. How do you understand that? He that overcometh. Who is he that overcometh? He that keepeth his works unto the end. How do you understand the overcomer? He that keepeth his word unto the end. How do you understand the overcomer? He that keepeth his will unto the end. He that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end. To him will I give power over the nations. Hold on. Turn it around. He that overcometh not. If this is what is promised to those who overcome, and by those who do not overcome, he that overcometh not and keepeth not my word, my will, my works unto the end, him will I not give power, no reward. I will not give power over the nations. Look at verse 27. In verse 27, it says, he shall rule them with a rod of iron. That's he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end. He shall rule them with a rod of iron. down as the vessels of a potter, shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. Look at the second part there. He that overcometh not shall not rule with a rod of iron. When those who overcome, when the Lord is telling them, rule over five cities, rule over two cities, the one that does not overcome, the unprofitable servant, and the servant that is compromising, does not have any backbone, and he does not overcome, he does not keep the word, the will, the work of God unto the end, there will be nothing to rule over. He would even lose his own soul. But he that overcometh, I will give him authority, I will give him power, I'll give him dominion. He shall rule them with a rod of iron, and as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. And then in verse 28, it says in verse 28, and I will give him the morning star. And I will give him the morning star. I vouch those who do not overcome, he will not give them the morning star. There will be no light to shine, no star to shine, no crown to wear, because they have not overcome. But he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, I will give him the morning star. And then he tells us now in verse 29, and he says, he that has an ear to hear, who is that? He who looks at the word, he that has an ear to hear, he obeys the counsel of the Lord. Who is that? He that has an ear to hear, he that will say, not Jezebel, enough is enough. This must not go on. That's the one that has ear to hear. The thing that God has against you, and the thing that Christ has against you, notwithstanding, I have somewhat against thee. The one that has an ear to hear will re-examine, will re-evaluate his ministry and say, look at what Christ has against me, and look at what he condemns in my ministry, in my style, my lifestyle, my ministerial style. He that has an ear to hear, let him hear. Let him hear. Don't let the devil block his ears. Let him hear. Don't let the noise of the people that want to carry on with Jezebel, don't let their noise block his ears. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. If you are a child of God, the Spirit of God has spoken to you. If you are a man of God, the Spirit of God has spoken to you. Because Jesus said that Spirit of truth will guide you into all truth and will bring to your remembrance all that has spoken unto you. And the Spirit of God has done that today. And he that has an ear will hear what the Spirit has said unto the churches. We're going to take everything the Lord has revealed to us. We're going to take it to the Lord in prayer. And you know, my brother, my sister, 5 minutes will not be enough, a few minutes will not be enough to go through everything the Lord has revealed to us. And we're not just learning to say, I attended the leadership development session on Tuesday. We're learning so that we'll put into practice all that the Lord is speaking unto us. And so it will demand that you go on your knees after this message, and then you look at everything and you want to correct everything the Lord wants corrected in your life and your ministry. Let's pray together. You can rise up and talk to the Lord even briefly now, even though you're still going to pray much and you're going to pray later. Let's talk to the Lord today and thank the Lord for what he has revealed unto us about cleansing the church. If the church is going to be cleansed, the leader of the church must be cleansed. Cleansed from compromise, cleansed from contamination, and cleansed from all the corroding, corrupting disease coming from Satan into the church. The cleansing of the church, the cleansing of the leader, the cleansing of the minister, the cleansing of all the ministers and the leaders, and the cleansing of the workers, and the cleansing of the ministry, and the cleansing of every section, and the cleansing of our hands, and purging ourselves through the word of God, so we can bear acceptable fruit unto the Lord. And then he tells us about the declaration declaration of the perfection of the conquering Christ. Let that conquering Christ, let him conquer every weakness in your life. Let the Son of God conquer every kind of compromise in your life. Let your heart hear, let your spirit hear the words of Christ, and let that heart come alive, because it says, we'll hear the voice of the Son of God, Son of Man, and then will come alive. And then let him have dominion, and let the fire coming from his eyes burn off every chaff and burn off everything that is not right in your life, anything that is not right in your ministry, anything that is not right in your comportment in the ministry. And then as he discerns, and he says, I know your works, he discerns and he says, I know your charity, he discerns and he says, I know your faith, he discerns, he says, I know your service, he says, I know your works. And the first to be more than the last. Is he saying that to you? Can you say that now you are more zealous, that now you are more earnest, that now you are more purposeful, that now you are more focused? Can you say that the last is more than the first? Can you say that your ministry today, your passion today, and your excitement in serving the Lord today, and your perseverance today, and your understanding today, and your focus today, and your ideal and your goal in serving the Lord today is more than what it was 10 years ago? More than what it was 20 years ago? Then that's the testimony the Lord had concerning this church. Let him have the same testimony concerning you. But then remember what he says, I have somewhat against you. You are the jellyfish leader. I have somewhat against you. You are the sugar daddy, the sugar mommy. Mommy is sweet, daddy is sweet, because she never corrects anybody, and she never, you know, says no to anyone. Is that the kind of leader you are? Is that the kind of minister you are? Shape up, stand up, and stand right, and stand straight, and do what the Lord has commanded you to do. If you're a man pleaser, if you're a woman pleaser, if you're a Jezebel preacher, and that you cannot talk to Jezebel, you cannot correct them, Christ says, I have somewhat against you. If you don't correct it now, when Christ comes and we appear before him, he would say, I told you, you didn't correct it, and I still have somewhat against you. Let's correct that. Let's say, Lord, I'll not be an unrestraining compromiser, a compromiser, a leader in the church that will not restrain the people that are going astray. Don't wait for the judgment, for the tribulation, for the torment of those unclean corruptors, of those unclean companions. Now the Lord is telling us what to do. Keep your distance. Keep your distance away from the people that will weaken you. Don't let them be your bosom friend, your familiar friend. Stay away from them, stay clear of them. The people that when you see them, you cannot say no. You want to take your stand, and you want to be firm, you want to be clear, you want to be obedient to the Lord. But your best friends are the people that will weaken your intent. You say, I'm going to keep my distance. I will not allow them to destroy me, or to destroy my ministry, or to destroy my future. And become steadfast to all the doctrines of the Bible, having steadfast devotion to the complete doctrines of the Word of God. Tell the Lord to help you. He helped Paul, he'll help you. He helped John the Beloved, he'll help you. He's helping some of us. In spite of challenges, he will help you. Help Martin Luther, all alone. The judge shall live by faith. He will help you. Help John Wesley. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. And he preached everywhere and never changed, never compromised till the end. He will help you. Help Charles G. Finney, standing on the word, and bringing revival everywhere he went, and recalling the people back to the narrow path everywhere he went. He'll help you. He can. He will. Like we learned the other time, become a hero. A hero that stands alone. Even if you have to stand alone for the word of God, stand. And then he'll give you reward on the final day. Stately dominion for conquering disciples and saints. Tell the Lord, accept the word. Don't take a jot out of what we had today. Don't take a tittle out of what we had today. Don't criticize. Don't edit. Don't put anything away. That's how the Lord wants to speak to us. Desperate situation demands desperate attention. Give all the attention the Lord requires and be faithful until the end, holding firm, holding fast his faithful word unto the end. And great will be your final reward. Father, we thank you today. We bless your name. We thank you because you have opened the pages of scriptures to us. You've spoken to us like leaders, ministers, servants that you love. And we pray, Lord, we'll accept your love. And accept the challenge and accept everything you've spoken to us. We pray, Lord, by the Spirit, by your grace, by your enablement, we'll correct everything that needs to be corrected in our personal lives, in our relationships, in our attitude, in our action, in our ministry, in our faithfulness, and in forthrightness. Help us to be who you want us to be in the ministry, in Jesus' name. And we pray abundant grace, sufficient grace, sustaining grace, strengthening grace you give to every one of us. Help us, Lord, to stand and to minister like good, effective, courageous soldiers of Christ. Help us not to bend the knee before Satan, not to weaken our hearts before Jezebel's, and not to close our mouths and become so careful that we cannot tell the truth before the compromisers and the corrupters. Help us, Lord, to be courageous conquerors every moment, every time, on the pulpit and outside the pulpit, anywhere we go. Help us, Lord, to keep a far distance from the people that might have any power to make us compromise, even if we have to lose friends and we have to lose familiar people. Help us, Lord, to stand firm, hold fast the word to the very end, so that none of your people will miss the reward and will miss the fulfillment of your promise here on earth and there in the great beyond. We thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.